So my name is Ronald Stubblefield. I'm a law student at NYU. I'm also originally from Washington, D.C. And I'm going to mention D.C. for two reasons. First, it's my hometown. I'm great to be back to speak to y'all. Second, because where I'm going to go with the story starts with my story in this city when I was 9 years old, to really drive this point home. 9 years old, I thought I was going to die. Understand, I was in the hospital, stomach problem. Nobody could diagnose what was wrong with me. I couldn't eat. I couldn't hold anything down. While I'm in Children's Hospital, I started observing some things. These things I think observed are probably the reasons what motivated me to want to fix some problems. It's probably what's the reason why I'm still alive today. Because I'm there, I'm watching a series of white patients. They have a need. Doctors are all rushing towards them. What do you need? What do you need? What do you need? What do you need? But then I think next door to this little boy of color, terminally ill, just constantly hitting on the nurse, help me, nurse, help me, watching him plead day in and day out for help. Getting ignored, people come by 2 hours, acting like he's faking it. Finally, he code reds. For those who don't know what code red means, it means he died because of inattentive care. And I watched these doctors, and they talked to his family. I'm in the next room. They forgot to close the door. Side note, those won't be medical lawyers, HIPAA. Make sure those doors, to advise your future doctors, close those doors in those situations because they're not supposed to disclose this information. But as I'm hearing, they're saying, we did best be good, but we couldn't understand this kid. And we don't see things with this kid, and we just can't relate to this kid. And as I thought of that, and that story always resonated with me as I grew up, in Montgomery County, where you take this nice little highway line, 270, where you watch all the resources where the Walt Whitmans, the Potomacs, where the white people are. And you go to the other side of the county, what's called the forgotten stepchildren of Montgomery County. You see lower resources. You see lower support. The only reason my high school got support because I had a sister named Jeanette Dixon, who to this day I'm forever thankful for, who believed in the power of diversity and would champion for people, not just to be at the table, but to be given the resources, tools needed to have full table privileges to manifest their own destiny. We all have a story like this or know somebody who has a story like this, and at the fundamental core, on the basis of ideas, on the basis of bias, people became victims of the accident of privilege. What can we do before how we're born? But on the basis of false ideas of supremacy on any basis, race, gender, sexuality, somebody could determine, because of their privilege on the other side, who was worthy of human investment and who was expendable as a human sacrifice. And if we're going to tackle the problems our previous speaker outlined on PowerPoint, you have to understand at the fundamental core, these problems are because we place supremacy and profits and things over human dignity. And if we're going to tackle those problems, it's going to have to be an embedded value that we push forward. Not just us at the table, not just us with table privileges to make sure our interests are looked out for, but we have to change the way we look at things, say, okay, it's nice that we're here. It's great that I'm here. I don't want another person to go through this problem again. We would have to fundamentally, through diversity and inclusion, think about a world where it's true both in principle and in practice. All humans are created equal, endowed with certain inalienable rights, life, liberty, and fair and equitable treatment in their pursuits of happiness. This is why diversity and inclusion matters. It's a battle for it's a battle for quality of life at the core. This is what Dr. Martin Luther King meant, that if we're going to revolutionize society, it's a values revolution. So the question, and this is what our people have dreamt of through decades, through centuries, through all their struggle, that hopefully one day their progeny could be in a world where this struggle is just a reality of the past. So the question for us today is, what must we do as future lawyers and current lawyers to take the hopes of our mothers and dreams of our fathers and turn them into actualities for our sons and our daughters? The very first thing to tie back into Paula's talk is understand something. You are worthy. You are worthy as a human being, and other people, other humans are worthy of the same dignity that you're entitled to. This means that not only do we protect, make sure that worth isn't disrespected by others, but we respect our hustle to make sure we respect it ourselves. Understand, you are entitled to be successful. You're worthy of success. Go earn it, but you're worthy of it. Don't ever doubt that. All the struggles that people talk about in law school as people of color, what's carried me through this day is knowing no matter how bad it gets, no matter what obstacles are in my way, not a single obstacle exists that this takes away from my worth. But then the second and more important piece is this. Every day you're gonna be faced with situations. They could be big, they can be small. But there'll be situations which should lead you to ask a few questions. Is this really what happened here, a fair outcome? What can I do to make this world a little more equitable each day, and how I treat people, and how I work with people, and how I communicate with people, but how I coach people? What resources will it take me to improve myself and to help self to better execute on that? What support will I need? Who do I need to call and execute? Because understanding something, diversity and inclusion is not a single person game, it's a team effort. We have to do it together as a people. You know, they're saying one person, himself, they can inspire, but until people are inspired to work with them, frankly, it doesn't matter. The third piece, third critical piece is understand, what does it mean to be a lawyer? You are an advocate. I don't know where your careers are gonna go. Some of y'all will be corporate lawyers. Some of y'all will be trial litigators. Some of y'all will be judges. Some of y'all will be politicians. Some of y'all will be business people. Some of y'all will become social entrepreneurs. And in all those things, you'll be different, shareholders and stakeholders you'll advocate for. Advocate for your values. You will have, by one of the privileges you all have and will gain through a law degree, is you have educational privilege. You have an advanced degree that puts you at the highest echelons of society in terms of education and in terms of sophistication as to how the system works. The choice and onus is on each of us as to what we will do with it. And the most critical piece, the youth. And I think of, and there's a mentor of mine who always looked up to me, he was my greatest hero. And he would love to say, you know, wisdom is, you know, wasted on the old. I'd like not to fully agree with him if we choose to listen to the elders and then take their what they've learned and the experiences we share and use with our time and energy of youth. That is our greatest asset. We have time. And we have energy. If history has taught us nothing, it's this. Every great social movement was led by the youth. You know, we think, everybody talks 60s, SNCC. Before SNCC, go look at the French Revolution. Look at your founding fathers. These were young men. It's the youth. Because you have time, because you have energy to see process through. It doesn't mean you'll succeed, may succeed in our lifetime, because these problems, quite frankly, are about as American as white baseball and apple pie. They are that embedded in the core of this country, which is why you want to use table privileges to build a new table. Because you can't build something worthwhile on pillars. And I'm telling you as an engineer, you cannot build a house worthwhile on a fundamentally flawed foundation. Let us build that new foundation. But if that is going to happen, we're going to have to do it because newsflash, it doesn't build itself. And to share this point, I was on the train a couple weeks ago, and one person came and said to me, well, you know, equality, that never existed in nature, so why should we fight for it? And you'll hear that argument more or less. Neither does microphones, neither do chairs, neither do overpriced three-piece suits. Those things don't exist in nature. It was the will of some human to bring it to an existence, and they're never ending desire to keep working until it existed. So don't ever buy that argument. It's something you have to want. And if you want it, work for it. And I'll be real, I'll be remiss. I'll tell you, the struggle is not easy. Later tonight, you'll hear from the Honorable Arthur Burnett, and he'll share with you the struggles he's seen over the years. But he'll also share with you some of the progress he's witnessed too. And what I want y'all to remember is this, no matter how heavy your struggles are, the magnanimity of them is forever eclipsed by the righteousness of our cause for bringing about a better world. Never forget that. That's what saves you from being jaded. We look at all these movements we see now, Black Lives Matter. This is what they understand. It's like, look, they say, look, we know it's hard. We know the struggle is real. but I'm willing to take everything in that struggle and use the best of my time and talents towards that end. You all want to be lawyers. You're going to learn how the system works. You'll learn how to guide someone through the system. You'll learn to be able to argue and understand the fundamental foundations which the system is built and be able to challenge and question its premises. And then you'll be able to go, and some of y'all become academicians who can use scholarly articles to say, this is a new way to approach law. Derrick Bell was a pioneer in that. But we need more people like Derrick Bells. We need Cheryl Powells. We need Seth Fowlers. We need Phil Paul to go back and teach and Paula Edgars to do it. Some of y'all will go into politics. And the fundamental thing about elected office that you will learn in admin law is this. For all your technical experts you have, value-laden judgments belong to the politicians. You get to put those values into place, and you get to question the existing values that are on the books. You'll be able to make sure people get a fair process. And while you make sure they get a fair process, you can study the system mechanics to show how can I make that process more fair and more equitable. You will get a chance to expose yourself to other groups of people and be able to share what you learn and guide and coach them. And you can start guiding and coaching right now. Everybody talks about mentorship is, oh, I gotta wait to be a success in this. Now, some of the greatest mentors I ever had were, ironically, younger kids than me, because they're able to share certain things, what they saw in the world that guided and shaped my perspective. And the final thing to conclude, because I know I'm the person between now and a nice break before the evening session, and I can see some of y'all's faces are like, oh, I want food, I'm tired, the struggle is real. I've been where you're at. I've been where you're at. I call it Monday through Fridays. Law school classes are about 2 hours a pop, and you got about 3 to 4 of them back to back, you get that look. So I understand. Please, if you remember nothing else and why I asked for this talk at this time in the program, was because I want to tie it all together. Because until you understand and can appreciate why this matters, the tools here you will never use to their fullest power. And I wanted you to get this and grasp this, understand this. This is a battle for the heart and soul and the betterment of mankind. That's what diversity and inclusion is about. And don't ever forget that you are now on the forefront to battle. And it's not a sprint. Let's be real, these are deep-seated. It's not going to be a marathon either. It's a relay. And your time, you may not get there, but you can push the envelope further so that somebody else behind you that you coach, you mentor, can take it further. So then in the end, we can add a fourth stanza to our national anthem that says, and now, victory is won. I thank you all for your time. Thank you, and God bless.